Hello, we are here to speak about applying address sanitizer to libstandard C++ containers. And I'll start with, we are members of Samsung Research Russia, and we work on toolchain for Tizen operating system. So Tizen is an RPM-based and Linux kernel-based operating system. We use GNU-based toolchains, so like Linaro GCC, glibc, binutils. And we have lots of C and C++ code to check. So we have to find as many ways to check it as we can. Now we apply address sanitizer to whole operating system. So how did we come to this? Basically, we have very distributed development community, many overseas centers, many contractors, and they all have different development environments. So we end up with applying address sanitizer not for individual developers, but for the whole operating system at once. A quick recap. We started the investigation of address sanitizer in 2013. Then it took about 2 years to apply it to Tizen applications, to tune, to execute. And then we succeeded to execute the whole operating system with address sanitizer applied. We had a speech about that on Cold Draw on 2017. Since then, we have Address Sanitizer as development tool with all required documentation, support, and so on. Then we applied regular system-wide testing with reporting of all dynamically found issues. And then we checked what's next. We tried to increase coverage for Address Sanitizer and started with annotating containers. So there are, there could possibly be issues with standard string and standard vector if you try to access between size and capacity, for example. When we started, we found that vector was already annotated in libstandard C++ for GCC. So we started with the string, and now I'll give a quick review of our testing environment. So we build GCC as a package for our build system, and we have two builds actually, one for our development purposes with a sanitized Bootstrap, and one non-sanitized GCC for project which tests actually operating system. Then we use OBS to build, thanks to guys from SUSE here. Each build is performed in isolated container, and theoretically, there is a way to apply address sanitizer via standard opt flags environment variable, but it became clear that it's not enough to use flags for each package. So we have compiler wrapper to apply options. I think everyone knows how it works. Then we have kind of environment to inject address sanitizer into every container and apply it into every tool used during build. So there are some custom patches. Basically, they're open, but I don't think someone needs them if they don't execute the whole operating system. Then we have build acceleration since our primary target is ARM architecture, but we still have x86 build servers. We execute two simultaneous environments in each build. So we check both x86 tools and ARM tools at once using QEMARM during build. And yeah, so build container looks like two sets of libraries and applications to execute both versions of code. So resulting test setup is looks like that. We have build container to check all build tools, and we have ARM device with address initializer with some custom patches to make it work for limited hardware. And then we test all the user space applications there. So that's our setup. And now to container annotation idea. So, Mikhail.
Hello, my name is Michael. I'm going to talk about containers annotations and containers overflow. Container overflow is just a memory access in between size and capacity. For example, in terms of standard container, this is memory access between end and container begin plus capacity. Some example with address initializer when we need to annotate containers. We have a vector, we pushed three elements on the top. Suppose we have capacity more than 3 and size is 3. Address initializer sees that third element is available. It's in the allocated memory region, so we could return it from the function, but it's a memory error and we can't detect it without annotating containers. This could be done with simple checks inside standard library with debug operators, but if we are accessing these raw memory addresses, this could only be done with container annotations for address initializer. Another side effect of annotating containers is improving leak sanitizer detector accuracy. For example, here we have four allocated ints inside vector, and without annotations, we don't know if they're available or not, as the primary region is still allocated before we are going to pop back the last element now. So, what we are going to do to annotate containers? Basically, we have a blue region that we want to annotate. So we want to say that if we have memory access inside this region, we want to address initializer report an error. To do this, address initializer provides one annotation function. We must supply annotating region borders and changing position between begin and end. So, for example, if we resize containers to have more to the greater size, old meat will be less than new meat. And we have a few constraints for the annotation for the container annotations. The main one is that the allocator must provide 8 bytes aligned regions. So by default, this is enabled for default address default libstdc++ allocator. Back to the std::string implementations. Inside libstdc++, we have two ABIs for std::strings, old one and new, namely copy-on-write strings and SSO strings. As we are using both implementations for our platform, so we have to annotate both ABIs, old and new. We are going to talk about std basic string for some template parameter, and this will cover all strings like string, UE8 string, and etc. There is no single place where we can annotate containers. We need to change string constructors, string destructors, assign operators, and etc. All pushbacks, popbacks, arrays, append, all free functions. So how annotations look like? Suppose we have initially this memory region where we already annotated blue region. So we detected an errors here. And we want to resize this container to the greater size, where SZ is greater than previous size. And so with annotations, the state of container will look like this. Now, we still can detect an errors inside blue region. Another note that we must be ensure of is support exception safety. So if exception will be thrown, annotations must be undone, so we don't end up with floating memory regions. We must clean up for exceptions. Another trick for new string KPIs is a small buffer. For example, for string less than 16 bytes, internal small buffer stored without memory allocations. So it's not annotated with address initizer. We don't have any red zones in the left or in the right. And for the big strings that are greater than 16 bytes, it's okay. So we have two choices. We could ignore small buffer optimization and we won't report any errors for small strings. Or we could disable small buffer and make strings fully dynamic. So we allocate memory regions even for small size and for the default one. This is quite runtime costly. And trick for old ABI for copy-on-write strings is that for our main target platform with 32 bits, we couldn't guarantee that the string will be 8-byte aligned. And this is one of the requirements for the address initizer. So if we want to fully annotate copy-on-write strings, we must align them inside libstd C++. And this will change strings ABI. So we must recompile all the string usage inside firmware. And as we recompile all the firmware at once, this is quite easy for us. By annotating std string, we also could detect errors inside other standard library classes, like fs, pass, regex class, stream, and etc. So, for the two ABIs, we have two annotations types. We could fully annotate strings, and ABI will be changed. So we must recompile all the environment. Or we could partially annotate std strings, and ABI will be preserved, and we could link with other applications that compiled. As we could see from this table, the best way and the easy one is partially annotate new ABI strings. For 32 bits and for 64 bits, ABI is unchanged, so it's quite easy to go. Results. Right after we enabled std string annotations, we found a few bugs inside libstd C++ that were reported. And we applied it to our firmware system and managed to run firmware with sanitized strings on the device with not quite high runtime overhead, but build time overhead was quite large. For example, our Chromium build for ARM 64 was in trouble. We couldn't build it without additional RAM usage. What's next? Right now we are doing the following tasks. We are experimenting with shadow scaling and shadow compaction. When we change how ASUN shadow memory is stored, we are going to enable hardware assistant sanitizer and also going to integrate with managed runtime languages. And the first victim is CoreCLR. Thanks. Actually, I have an example how std strings annotations produced a report, so you could see an error. But this is on this notebook, and we couldn't connect it. So if you want to look at it, you could come after the presentation. I think that's all.
And one more thing we wanted to ask, I think that everyone from Red Hat left already. We had, so could you find Jonathan Wakely and ask him to merge our patch? We discussing it since last year, maybe.
Actually, this work was done 2 years ago, and I've pinged Wakely a few times on the mail list, but I pinged for about 3 months.
So that was my question, actually.
My two, actually. Well, of course, you have some changes which are ABI changing, and that's probably not possible for upstreaming. Not desirable, but for those changes which are not ABI changing.
This ABI changes is controlled by define. So we could choose how we want to build libstd C++ with changed ABI or without.
Yeah, well, Jonathan is not here, unfortunately, but yeah, I would see he could have issues with that, but with those non-ABI changes, I think that's certainly desirable, especially if we have already such similar setup for std vector.
Oh yes, but std vector does not change any ABI.
And for the local buffers, the question is also if you couldn't just use different libasun functions to just in the constructor. When you know the size of the string, of course, if it's 16 bytes, then there's you need all bytes zero, of course, in the shadow memory because you want to use it. But if it's smaller, then perhaps mark the rest of the string as something that shouldn't be touched, and in the destructor, destruct it again. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the question is if that won't be an API change as well, because if you construct the string in one shared library and destruct in a different one, which one was built with address sanitizer and the other one
wasn't. Yes, exactly.
So
if we merge in two shared libraries compiled with address sanitizer and without address sanitizer, this is not compatible also.
So basically our idea was to run as much tests as we can. So basically it's two different builds. When we build the fully checked firmware, we just can rebuild the whole system with the API, which is compatible with each other.
So as Jakub mentioned, it should be definitely possible to annotate also the local small buffer. I can help you if you want this issue.
Oh, okay, great.
That's basically what we do for stack variables at the. So we.
But is it possible if we pass it through registers or like that?
You basically know the address of the array, and you can directly. They do have a call which just mark shadow memory.
Because, well, we have those FFC and F1 and so bytes, but for the if the content of the 8 bytes next to each other contains valid data and then invalid data, then we use those 127 bytes as well, and it handles that case as well.
And I have a question about the scaling, or so by default it's 1 to 8.
1 to 8, yes.
So if you change it to 1 to 16, you will have issues with alignment, which will be required. Is it possible on ARM32 to have bigger alignments needed?
Do you mean annotating containers with different SN scaling?
No, I mean generally changing the scaling will lead in issues with alignment requirements.
Oh yes, we need to change something like this align attribute, and if allocator is capable of giving right aligned
I'm also talking about stack alignments, which. So if you have stack variables, you will need a higher alignment of these.
Oh yes,
and that's the question: if the target is capable of.
Well, I think all targets are capable of that. Basically, we have the special case of x86, which has full code of dynamic stack realignment, and all the other targets basically implement more aligned variables than the target can handle by built-in alloc. Basically, it's ugly, but it works. And of course, every target can improve that, but.
Which is slower.
It's slower and it has overhead, but it works.
Right now, for stack variables inside GC, the minimum alignment is, the minimum red zone size is 16. But with upper scalings, we need to bump this limit also. We have a patch for that. It's just in testing stage right now.
And it's changing ABI of libasn, and so it's ABI. It's a different ABI of the runtime library of sanitizers.
Yeah, we must build GCC and libasn together with these changes.
And I have a question about the other containers. Are you planning to cover the, I don't know which one, lists, whatever?
Before this presentation, a few weeks ago, I've annotated studdec, but it looks like it works based on test results. So maybe we are going to upstream this also.
So we started with this container because we could find issues. So we know where to look to find issues between size and capacity.
and it's not so obvious for other containers, so their priority was lower.
Thanks.